The topic is a little bit different from what I usually present. This is very practical. It's not a very highbrow topic about a new methodology or something. It shares a really interesting observation that we came across in a study from EMA, but I'll get to that a little later. That study was actually about enterprise service management, but it has a very interesting spin on what organizations can do to drive usage of their self-service portal. Because if we look at how employees reach out to the service desk, and I'm talking about the IT service desk here, historically, that has been via the telephone and email. And then organizations, they started to realize that okay, it's really expensive to have the phones manned 24/7. It would be great if people could get some help online through a self-service portal. And that could also save us some money on the number of service desk agents that we need to staff the service desk during the daytime. So the self-service portal was born. This was about, 25 years ago or something. So quite a long time ago already, and self-service has been evolving. But what many IT departments still mention is that they find it hard to drive the usage to or the usage of the self-service portal away from the telephone, away from email. But every time they try, they still see that a lot of the interactions, they come through the phone or email. They really struggle to get the percentage of new requests that come in up through the self-service portal. So this presentation looks at a couple of ways to drive more traffic to the self-service portal so that IT can reduce the staff that just does call taking and focus more on actually resolving those tickets. And this is all part of this whole shift left movement that we see in IT organizations, which makes a lot of sense. But there are some basics first. There are some things that a self-service portal must have in order for people to start using it. These are the very basics. This is not the thing that will magically get people to start using it. But the very first thing that we found over the years is that if people need to sign in with a username and password, then you can forget about it altogether. People will just say, I'll pick up the phone. Yeah, the number for the service desk is behind this button. I just press it and I get somebody who can help me. Or I'll just send an email. It's just easier. So single sign-on is really critical. So most organizations, they have either Active Directory from Microsoft installed, or they have Azure Active Directory nowadays in the cloud. And it tends to be really easy to integrate that with any service management tool that offers a self-service portal capability. So that is a step that most organizations already have taken care of. Now, the ease of use is not always as great, but it's critical. And with ease of use, I mean, there should not be all that many options. End users should definitely not need to be trained on self-service. It should be self-explanatory, but it should also be very responsive. It needs to be fast. Because otherwise, again, people will say, if I need to wait 3 seconds to get to the next screen, or to every time I click it, I see this spinner. Yeah, it gets really annoying. they'll start calling again. So the next thing that a self-service portal really needs to have is forms. So it's okay to have a basic form where somebody can say, okay, this is my issue and submit. But there are a lot of standard requests that people go to the self-service portal for that should collect some information from the user. So for example, somebody may want to have access to a shared directory, a shared folder on the company's network. And then it would be nice if there would be a form for this that would have some options where the user can quickly select exactly what he or she needs and hit submit. That is helpful for the user. The user doesn't need to think about, okay, what information do I need to provide to the IT department for them to be able to complete this request. It also helps them fill it out more quickly, the request itself. But on the other side, the side that receives the request, it is also tremendously helpful because they get exactly the information they need to complete the request successfully without having to call back the end user, which is just really frustrating. So if the end user gets a call back an hour later, and it's just somebody who says, okay, we still need this information from you, then the user thinks, oh my goodness, I should have called the first time. Yeah. So the next thing that a self-service portal must provide, obviously, is knowledge. Yeah, frequently asked questions, answers to frequently asked questions, and knowledge articles that provide instructions so that the end user can help themselves. Yeah, the end users, they may not need the help during office hours when the service desk is available. They may need it in the middle of the night, or they simply don't feel like talking to somebody or explaining the issue. They just want to get to a solution themselves and basically resolve it for themselves. Yeah. The next point that is really important in a self-service portal, and it may sound really obvious, but it needs to have search capabilities. Search capabilities to help the end user find what they're looking for. So to help them find the knowledge article that will provide them the instructions on how to fix the issue themselves, or to submit a standard service request to go into the request fulfillment process. Yeah, that form, to be able to quickly look that up, is very handy. But that means that the search capability needs to be pretty smart. So it doesn't necessarily need to rely, or it shouldn't rely on exact matches using the keywords that the user provided. Over time, the people in the IT department should be able to optimize the search by looking at the search phrases that people have used in the self-service portal to look for information, but were not able to find anything. Then they can say, okay, they were looking for this standard request. Maybe they wanted to ask for a new laptop. Then they used some different terminology that was not in the standard request, so they couldn't find it. So we should add those keywords into the standard request form so that it will be found the next time somebody uses that search phrase. So search, it may sound very simple, but using some kind of artificial intelligence, self-learning capability also helps tremendously from the end user perspective. If they can easily find what they're looking for in the self-service portal, obviously they will find it more helpful and therefore will hopefully return to the self-service portal instead of calling the service desk. Now, the last thing that I would now consider a must-have, you may disagree, but it is the ability to have a smartphone app available so that people can easily use the self-service portal on their smartphone. Yeah, so the smartphone essentially has an icon on it that is the help icon for the enterprise employee, initially only for IT perhaps, but later as organizations tend to move into enterprise service management, it will be the help button for pretty much anything. Yeah, so those are the must-haves for at least an IT self-service portal. Now, let's take a look at the EMA study, the Enterprise Management Associates study that was carried out by Valerie O'Connell. She's their research director, and she is an analyst who I've worked with for a while now, and I find her one of the best analysts for ITSM. She really has a lot of knowledge about service management, how organizations use it, how they've implemented it across the world. And she has done a lot of research in that area, and it shows. But a recent study, she published the results of in May of this year, had something that struck me. It was a study about enterprise service management, ESM, and it looked at what actually happens when an organization evolves from having ITSM for the IT department to ESM, applying ITIL principles, ITIL processes to other functions within the enterprise. Yeah, and she found, for example, that the most popular business function to expand into is HR. Facilities is another one, but purchasing, finance, is also another one that is really high on the list. But when I look at the customers that we serve with ForMe, we see that customers use it on the factory floor whenever they need to change out production streets to start producing a different product. And they use the service management tool to ensure that the whole workflow gets completed, that the sign-offs are there before they actually start production, but also for managing the parking spaces, so that people can reserve it, for example, reserve them. Then pool cars are maintained, so people can request travel, plane tickets, for example, through the same processes that they're used to from the IT department. Now, what this study found is that it does, in fact, alter the relationship that IT has with the business. This was one of the very surprising things that came out of this study. The thing it found is that once other functions within the business start using the principles of ITSM to support the enterprise employees, the business functions, they start to better understand IT and where they're coming from. And they start to share a language, and they also start to collaborate with each other. Because typically what happens is the organization starts in the IT department with the deployment of an ITSM tool. And it doesn't really matter which tool you are using. The same ideas apply regardless of the tool. So the IT department has an ITSM tool, and then maybe someday the HR director logs on and goes into the self-service portal of the IT department and is able to find some knowledge articles that help the HR director. So the HR director starts thinking, well, this is really cool, actually. Why don't we have something like this? Why are all the employees still using email to contact the HR department? It's a mess because emails get lost. People in the HR departments, they go on holiday, so nobody else is taking care of these cases. So having something like a self-service portal also to share all the knowledge that is available within the HR department with the enterprise employees, that would be tremendously helpful. So the HR department starts to talk to the IT director, and the IT director then says, oh, yeah, that would indeed be useful for you as well. So let's see if we can use the tooling that we have to expand into HR as well. So that is kind of the story of how things evolve within the enterprise. And what they saw at EMA is that enterprise service management is now starting to become mainstream, which means pretty any enterprise is doing it. And we see that with our customers also. It's an evolutionary step to go from ITSM to ESM, where more functions within the business that support enterprise employees start using the same tool and the same processes. The returns, the ROI on expanding an existing tool are, it's pretty obvious that the returns would be very quick, because the tool is already in place. It just needs to be expanded. Single sign-on is already working and those kind of things. Everything is working already. It just needs to be expanded for the other functions. Yeah, and you can take this one by one. Not all functions will go at the same time, obviously. So maybe you expand first into HR and then go to another business function, et cetera, et cetera. But the returns, it pays off within months. So the improved collaboration, that was another finding, because now when a new employee joins, the HR department has a whole workflow that needs to be executed. But some of these steps, they need to go to facilities management to make an office available for the new employee, for example. And some of these steps need to be completed by the IT department. For example, a new email address needs to become available for this new employee. So this cross-functional collaboration is something that was very apparent. And then the main thing that struck me was that going from ITSM, expanding that into at least one other business function increased the use of the self-service portal that IT had made available. So what actually happened is that organizations that go from ITSM to ESM end up in this virtuous cycle. So because now it is not just a self-service portal for IT, but employees can also contact, for example, HR through the same self-service portal, employees start using self-service more. And when they start using self-service more, they become more comfortable with the interface. face-to-face. And maybe they used to use self-service 3-4 times a year to contact the IT department. Once they also need to use the self-service portal to contact the HR, then they start using it maybe 10, 20 times a year. It goes up quite a bit as more business functions become available in the same self-service portal. And it is very important that the same self-service portal is used. If the employees need to go to a different URL, a different web address, to go and get help from HR versus IT, then it doesn't help. And it certainly doesn't help if the whole user experience is completely different when they submit a request for HR versus IT. But assuming that the self-service portal, the behavior within the self-service portal is the same regardless of what kind of assistance is needed, then employees get more comfortable more quickly this way. And once they get more comfortable, they start thinking, I need help from HR or IT. I know where to go and it's easy. So actually, because they're more comfortable, they start using it more. And as people get more comfortable with it, they start saying to other business functions like facilities management or finance or legal or maybe the cafeteria, why don't you also make it possible for me to request such things from you using our enterprise self-service portal? So then more functions join and people start using it more and they become more comfortable, etc., etc. So that's the virtuous cycle. And what it roughly looks like as more functions join on a smartphone, it could look something like this. So they have a big search button. They can search for anything. If they're not quite sure whether a request about payroll needs to go to IT or human resources, it doesn't matter. They just search for it. They submit the request and the service management tool will figure out, okay, this needs to go to human resources and we'll route it accordingly. Now, to encourage self-service even more. So the study from the Enterprise Management Associates, that clearly showed that you get into this virtuous cycle when you start going from ITSM into ESM. That is the really, really powerful thing. But there are a couple of more things that you can do that I would quickly like to point out. And those are as follows. So you will hear a lot about virtual agents, AI incorporated into self-service. And the results currently are still mixed. Some organizations that are quite successful with it. Actually, very few are quite successful with it. But a few have seen some positive results already. The main requirement for a good virtual agent is not that it looks friendly or can be funny or whatever. But what really matters for an organization is that through the use of a virtual agent, they can reduce the number of tickets that get submitted from the self-service portal to the IT department, for example. Now, what that requires is for the virtual agent to know quite a lot. First of all, about the user. So if the user works in finance, for example, and uses SAP, then it makes sense for the virtual agent to propose knowledge articles related to SAP if it thinks that the question is about SAP. But what is really annoying is that if somebody who doesn't use SAP, but asks a question from the virtual agent, gets a response from the virtual agent that lists a number of knowledge articles that relate to SAP. That doesn't make any sense to the user. And then the user will switch off and say, okay, I am not going to use the virtual agent anymore. But the goal of the virtual agent is to reduce that number of tickets that comes in. So the virtual agent needs to try to understand what the user is looking for. And ideally, the user is looking to help him or herself. So the virtual agent will propose one or a few knowledge articles that should allow the user to take care of his or her own problem. If a knowledge article cannot be found, then it's probably because the user is asking for a standard service request. So the user wants to get a local printer installed on his or her desk. Virtual agent is then going to say, okay, I found this form for you. If you submit it, then we'll take care of it. That works also very well. And then if the virtual agent cannot find anything, then the virtual agent says, okay, would you like me to submit a request for you? Based on the knowledge that the virtual agent has already gathered, the virtual agent should be able to do that. So this is how a virtual agent should work, but it requires the virtual agent to know which services the user is entitled to use and normally uses. So the services that the user is covered for by an active SLA, as well as the knowledge that is available for all those services and the standard requests that are available for those services. So that is what is needed to make your virtual agent successful. Now, another thing that may drive more self-service usage is workflow automation. So for example, if somebody requests access to a shared drive, then as soon as this request is submitted, the workflow starts, and the first step in the workflow is to obtain approval from somebody within the organization for this person to have access to that drive. That workflow should also inform the requester that the request is now waiting for the approval of this person. Yeah, so the tool should automatically figure out based on whatever information is in the tool that the right approver for this requester and this drive is this person, but then feedback that information to the user so that the user understands that the IT department is waiting for the business, somebody within the business, to provide approval. If things take too long, it's not the fault of the IT department, but getting that instant feedback for the user is also really helpful, because the user will see that, I didn't need to wait to get somebody on the phone. I didn't need to type in a whole email, and I see immediate results. The next thing is automated provisioning. So taking it one step further, so through the automation workflow, you can gather the necessary approvals and then assign a task to a specialist so that the requested work is actually carried out. But better ways, of course, to automate that last step where the provisioning is automated. And that is something that will really delight the end users, because if they use a standard request to ask for something, they see immediately that the right approvals are collected, and they see immediately after it has been approved, the requested access is provided. So that is another thing that will encourage people to come back to the self-service portal. Now, what we saw from the study is that the more people use the self-service portal, the more they continue to use it, essentially. And another way to get people to use the self-service portal more, we found with our customers, is that if the organization does time tracking for all its employees, then let them use a very simple, easy to use interface to track their time. And if the self-service portal is able to provide that really easy and responsive functionality for time tracking, then people come back more often to the self-service portal. Another way to increase the usage of the self-service portal is to allow project managers to assign project tasks to anybody in the organization. Not just people who have a license for project management, but to anybody. And the end users will then get a notification on their smartphone. They see that the project task is that a project task is assigned to them. They can pick it up. They can register their time against it, etc. And that again increases the use of self-service portal, of the self-service portal, making sure that people get more comfortable and hence come back more often. Yeah, hopefully these provide some practical ideas that you can use within your organization, regardless of which service management tool you use today, to help drive more traffic away from the phone and email to the self-service portal. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for sitting into this session. And Peter, I'll hand it back to you.
Thank you very much, Cor, for that interesting presentation. To the audience, is there any questions you have? Otherwise, I have a couple. So, all right, if there is no questions right now from the audience, I would be interested in when an IT organization hasn't really populated themselves a fully functional self-service portal, would that already make sense at that time to discuss with other departments on using it as well? Or would you recommend to first look that it works all properly in the IT before you make the next step to EMS?
Yeah, we've seen customers go either way. And what is interesting is that since sort of 2 years ago, we've seen customers start with HR rather than IT. So the IT department, they had their help desk, they had everything in place, they had an ITSM solution, but self-service, they never really got around to implementing it. They tried it, but it never took off. And then the HR department would come to us and they'd say, we're not going to wait for IT. Yeah, they don't take it seriously. Let us have a proper self-service portal with proper knowledge management behind it. And then we'll see if we can later convince the IT department to join our portal. And that has worked as well. So it more depends on where the need is. If the IT department doesn't really feel the need to perfect the self-service portal, but the HR department is really serious about it, or purchasing, for example, then let them do it. But ideally, yeah, keep everybody on the same ITSM tool. So I'm not encouraging people to go out and buy a new tool, but sometimes when there is an ITSM tool that is relatively old and that is not able to provide good self-service functionality, then it may be better for everybody to move to a different tool. But then to start in a different department, let them see how it works, and then let IT look at that and see if that could also work for them.
Yeah, I think that human resources you know, the usage is pretty limited. I mean, there isn't so much what you can offer there as self-service. Have you got experience in, I mean, for example, every company has a support department for their products or for whatever they sell. Mm-hmm. Usually they have a completely different tool and a completely different setup. Would that make sense to bring IT and support together? I mean, that probably yes. would be quite a big project then.
Right? Yeah. So what we see is that, so the client service management, that is a different ball game because you don't know the people who contact you. They can be anonymous or at least in the beginning. So that is a little tricky, but in essence, the processes are very similar.
Very similar.
So I really encourage organizations to look at that. But there's one thing that the IT organization will find as soon as they start talking to other functions. So that could also be the people who deal with the consumers of their products. Mm-hmm. The whole security and privacy thing becomes really important. Mm-hmm. So in IT, if it's shielded to just IT, then it's fine. But as soon as other functions, particularly HR, gets involved, the information that gets stored in the tool is really sensitive. Yeah. So the segregation of that data is super, super important. So before they can do anything in terms of considering enterprise service management, all working on the same tool, that data segregation has to be validated. Okay?
So you're speaking about the DSGVO, the data protection.
Absolutely. Okay. Yes. Yes. Yeah. But just imagine, we see this a lot with client support. They will give, for example, credit card numbers, things like that. Super sensitive data that you don't want the other specialists who work in IT or in HR to be able to see. That would be terrible. Each function needs to have its own bubble, more or less, its own account that it can configure for its needs, but still be able to use that same self-service front end for the employees and still be allowed to work together with the other functions in a secure fashion. And once you start talking about those kind of requirements, then many organizations find that, okay, maybe we should consider a new service management solution because what we're using today is not set up for that.
Okay, okay. Within this study, what you had just mentioned, did they also talk about the obstacles in implementing this kind of?
Yeah. It's interesting because there were none. And the main obstacles that they found were technical integrations with other tools to collect knowledge, for example, or data that they need to help the specialist process the requests more quickly. But this is very much an evolutionary thing. Where the obstacle is the resistance from people following certain processes. And what they found is that it is so natural now to follow kind of ITIL processes, at least for handling requests, that the functions that want to start using the same self-service portal, they knock on the IT department's door if they have done a good job with their self-service portal. So they're asking to join. And then when one other function has joined, then typically you will find that more and more functions will get the same idea. They start thinking, so it's not just for IT. Yeah. Why don't we have this as well?
It's like a snowball, you know, when people recognize something works, then they want to jump onto the bandwagon. Yeah.
Exactly. So the technical issues, that is more tool related and having the capability to integrate other systems like SAP, for example, from which you want to collect some HR data, for example. Those are the obstacles, but very often those should not be an obstacle when you go live, depending on the capabilities of the current tool that you have. It's more for when you want to improve, make it more efficient and more automated specifically.
Okay. Thank you very much, Cor. Is there any other questions from the audience? No. Where would you be available, at your booth or?
I need to run actually, but our booth is staffed by proper German-speaking people, and I apologize for having to do this in English, but they will be there all day.
Okay.
And they really look forward to speaking with everybody. All right?
Okay. Thank you very much, and have a good day. Goodbye.
Yeah, real pleasure, Peter. Thank you so much.